So we have dealt with two of the great Bibles under the history of the English Bible, the Wycliffe and the Tyndale. We have one remaining, and that is the King James Bible of 1611. There were several revisions of the Tyndale that lay between the Tyndale and the 1611, which we will mention in passing. The first was the Coverdale Bible of 1535, printed in Antwerp and brought into England in 1536, the Coverdale Bible. Now here is a copy of the Coverdale of 1549 from the collection here at the college, at the university. Coverdale Bible, you can see it's quite large. And then there was, and that was by Miles Coverdale, picture of him, Miles Coverdale. He wasn't very good looking, but he was a Bible translator. He was converted through the reading of the Scriptures and left the Catholic priesthood, fell in love with the Word of God. Later he wrote, "Whatever the Scripture is known, wherever the Scripture is known, it reformeth all things." And why? Because it is given by inspiration of God. And there were different times he had to flee England, go to Europe, and then he would come back as times of persecution would ebb and flow. But his was the first complete English Bible, but of course it was mostly Tyndale's. And then the Matthew's Bible. The Matthew's Bible was printed and also in Antwerp and brought into England. And John Rogers was the editor or translator of this, Matthew's Bible. Thomas Matthew was a pen name that he had assumed because of the persecution, I suppose, of those days. The Matthew's Bible was intended for very serious study. And it contained a collection of biblical passages that exhorted the reader to study the Scriptures. It had a summary of Bible doctrine that had been taken from a French Bible, and it had a concordance on Bible subjects that was also taken from a French Bible. So it was a study Bible, the Matthew's Bible. Old John Rogers. John Rogers knew William Tyndale, was a friend of William Tyndale. And John Rogers followed Tyndale into the flames, gave his life for the testimony that he had for Christ. Old John Rogers had a large family, had 11 children, and one was a little nursing baby at the time of his death. When they came and arrested him, he had to say goodbye to his wife, and that's the last time that he saw her until he was walking to the stake on that last day. And she was there with those children, holding that little nursing baby, watching her husband go to the flames. He asked for permission to have his family visit him, but the authorities were too cruel for that and denied it. And so he said goodbye to his wife as he was walking to the stake. John Rogers, Matthew's Bible. And then we have the Great Bible. It's called because it was big. Wasn't a pocket Bible. You had to have a wheelbarrow to carry this Bible around, or a servant. And it was printed in England and published in 1539. It was a revision of the Matthew's Bible. And copies of that were placed in all the churches of England then. In 1543, the fickle Henry VIII, again, after a time of quiet, when he had allowed the distribution of some of those Bibles, again demanded the destruction of all the translations bearing the name of Tyndale, and again forbade the common people to read the Bible in English, in private or in public. They had been enjoying that for a few years, even under Henry. Here is a picture of a man standing with the Bible there, a great Bible, it looks like, in one of the churches, and the candles are there. It's at night, and people are sitting around, and he's reading the Bible to them. It's the first time they've ever heard it. And they were amazed at what it said. But Henry forbade that to happen again. And then the Geneva Bible was translated and by those that fled the persecution. And particularly they had fled persecution after Henry and after his son Edward's short reign, a Catholic Queen Mary came to the throne. And many had to flee, and many went to Geneva, and there is where the Geneva Bible was finished. The New Testament was finished during Mary's reign, and the Geneva Bible, it was a very, very influential Bible. The entire Bible was printed in 1560. The Geneva Bibles were ordinarily printed in small sizes, convenient for missionary use. That's what the small Bibles were for. The Waldenses had small Bibles before this. And the first Bible, English Bible, to contain verse divisions throughout was the Geneva Bible. Before that, the English Bibles were divided into chapters and paragraphs, but that was the first one divided into verses throughout. The Geneva Bible quickly became the prominent English Bible, and it was very, very powerful in its influence for almost 100 years until the King James Bible superseded it. The Geneva Bible was the Bible carried to America by the first settlers from England, and it continued to be printed in England until 1617 and continued to be printed in Europe until much later than that, even after the King James Bible. And then there was the Bishop's Bible. The Bishop's Bible, so called because it was produced by bishops in the Church of England. Bishops. But still, primarily it was the old Tyndale Bible, the Bishop's Bible. Never was very popular. People loved the Geneva Bible. For example, between 1568 and 1611, there were only 20 editions of the Bishop's Bible printed, but there were 120 editions of the Geneva. And so you can see what the people loved and what Bible that they went to. The Bishop's Bible. And we come now to the King James Bible, which all of these other Bibles preceded. The most famous Bible of the Reformation in England was the King James Bible, also called the English Authorized Bible. Gets its name from King James I of England, who authorized its translation. King James, all dooted out there. A new edition of the English Bible was proposed at a conference which was held at Hampton Court, Hampton Palace, which is down the river away from London. And the kings used to take their own special royal barge down the river, and they would go there. Very interesting place. I've toured that. Anne Boleyn was there. All of his wives were there a little bit. They had a conference there in 1604. And the Puritans, who were trying to reform the Church of England, presented a petition called the Millennium Petition, calling for reformation of the Church of England. And the leader of that group, John Reynolds, proposed that new translation, and the king agreed. He thought it was a good idea. And within 6 months, a list of 54 scholars was drawn up. And it worked out that only 47 to 50 actually did the work. There's some died, whatever. But 47 to 50 men actually did the translation on the King James Bible. And so, the translation started in 1607. The group was divided into six companies. It's very important to understand how the King James Bible was translated. This is our heritage. This is our Bible. It's unique. In the whole history of Bible translation, it's unique. The group was divided into six companies. And each company was assigned a portion of the Scripture to translate. Six companies. Like part of the prophets, the historical books, and divided up. And the first thing that happened was that each member of that company would each member take that portion of Scripture to which he was assigned and translate that, each member of the company, separately. This was rule number 8 of these rules that were drawn up for the King James Bible, which said, every particular man of each company to take the same chapter or chapters, and having translated or amended them severally by himself where he thinks good. So each one did his own private work. Then the company as a whole met together. This was also rule number 8, which said, all to meet together to confer what they have done and agree for their part what shall stand. And so, rule number 8 was that they privately translated and then met together and agreed on one translation of that portion of the book. When a company completed its portion, that portion was then sent to all 5 other companies that they would review, so that each part of the translation went through the hands of every company, 6 companies. And in that manner, they did the work. Now that's rule number 9, which said, as any one company hath dispatched any one book in this manner, they shall send it to the rest to be considered of seriously and judicially. And so, each book of the translation was reviewed by all of the companies. Not only that, but if there was some particularly difficult word or passage, they were instructed to get help from anyone in the kingdom who would, anyone that would have wisdom and skill to give them assistance. Now, when the books were received by the companies, it appears that their method was that one of the members of the company, there were 7 or so members, would read that translation aloud, verse by verse, and the other members of the company would sit there with a translation, a respected translation, or a Greek and Hebrew text, whatever was necessary, comparing that reading to what he had before him, so that it was just thoroughly, constantly sifted. Do you see what happened? This has never happened before, or since. And not only that, but learned men, anyone in the kingdom that had some idea about the translation and could send his ideas and to the committee, and they were to consider those. And so it was a very thorough work. The finished product from each company was then submitted to a 12-man committee who was composed of the 2 chief men from each company. And they then determined the final translation and prepared it for the press. And so, as the number of the companies was 6, and the number of in each company varied from 7 to 10 men in a company, it follows that each part of that translation was examined at least 14 different times as it went through that process. Many times, 15 and even 17 times. The basic translation took 2 years, and then 9 months were required for the revision and the final preparation for the press. 2 years, 9 months. That was considered the printing of the King James Bible. Was first printed in 1611. It was printed by Robert Barker, a very large volume. On its title page, it said, the Holy Bible, containing the Old Testament and New, newly translated out of the original tongues, and with the former translations diligently compared and revised by His Majesty's special commandment. And down all the way till 1709, the Barker family held the sole right and their consigns to print the English Bible, the King James Bible in England, Barker family. Now the translators of the King James Bible. The translators of our Old English Bible were scholars of the highest caliber. Alexander McClure, who published a biography of those translators back in 1855, said this about them, 1855, It is confidently expected that the reader of these pages will yield to the conviction that all of the colleges of Great Britain and America, even in this proud day of boastings, could not bring together the same number of divines equally qualified by learning and piety for the great undertaking. And not today either. In fact, especially not today. Everyone whose wits are filled with worldly things. Especially not today. It's not going to be done again. Almost all of those translators were masters of Greek, Hebrew, and Latin. Masters. We're not talking about the little dabbling we do today. We're talking about masters. That was just a basic part of what was called a classical education of that day. Why, you grew up with Latin. You spoke Latin as well as you did English. You spoke Greek as well as you did English. You spoke Hebrew as well as you did English. Show me somebody today that's 5 years old and can read the Hebrew Bible like one of these translators of the King James Bible did. 5 years old. Masters. Scholars today, ordinarily, do not even start learning those languages until their mature adult years. These men grew up with it as babes. There's a difference. At Oxford and Cambridge in those days, in the 1500s and 1600s, all of the printed texts were in Latin. Nothing was in English. You didn't speak in English. All of the compositions, all of the lectures, all the disputations were in Latin. Erasmus, when he taught at Cambridge in the early 1500s, Erasmus did not speak a word of English. Erasmus didn't speak English. How did he speak? Latin and Greek. All the students understood him perfectly well. You show me a Bible college today in America where that's true. It's not. They didn't only know those languages such as Hebrew and Latin and Greek. They knew many of them, all the cognate languages, associated languages, Aramaic and Persian and Coptic and Syriac and Chaldee and the other languages that you need to know to dig into the history and genealogy of the Bible. By the way, in 1605, of the 6,000 volumes in the Oxford University, guess how many were in English? 60. They weren't dealing in English. They're dealing in Latin and Hebrew and Greek. And we're talking about a different time, different caliber of scholarship. And they had the ability not only to read the modern editions of those languages. It's one thing to read modern Greek. It's a whole other thing to read ancient Greek manuscripts. And so, their scholarship was of the highest caliber. Consider some examples. Lancelot Andrews had mastered 15 languages. Miles Smith was expert in Hebrew, Chaldee, Syriac, Latin, Greek, and Arabic. They were as familiar to him as his mother tongue. Henry Saville, a very weighty Greek scholar, very famous. Henry Saville, the first to edit the complete works of Chrysostom, John Boyce. He's the one that could read the whole Bible in Hebrew at age 5. William Bedwell, one of the best Arabic scholars of his time. Edward Lively, one of the most eminent scholars of Hebrew alive of that day. John Reynolds, the famous Puritan, who asked the king to do the translation, was on the committee. It was said that his memory and learning were near a miracle. All Europe at that time could not have produced 3 men superior to Reynolds, Jewell, and Usher. All of Europe. And that was a great day of scholarship. Richard Brett was an eminent linguist in Latin, Greek, Hebrew, Chaldee, Aramaic, Ethiopic. These are just some examples of the scholarship of those men. But they weren't only scholars. They were humble men. They knew that only God could give the wisdom to translate the Bible. All the scholarship in the world will never give a man the ability to accurately translate the Bible because it's a spiritual book. They knew that. To that purpose, this is what they wrote in their preface, the original translator's preface. To that purpose, there were many chosen to translate that were greater in other men's eyes than in their own, and that sought the truth rather than their own praise. In what sort did these assemble? In the trust of their own language, or of their sharpness of wit, or deepness of knowledge, judgment? As it were, an arm of flesh at no hand. They trusted in him that hath the key of David, opening and no man shutting. They prayed to the Lord, the Father of our Lord, to the effect that St. Augustine did, O, let thy scriptures be my pure delight. Let me not be deceived in them, neither let me deceive by them. In this confidence and with this devotion did they assemble together, not too many, lest one should trouble another, and yet many, lest many things might escape them. Not too many, not too few. Very wise translation work. Everything about it was done with great wisdom. I wonder where that wisdom came from. King James? No. It didn't even come from those men themselves. It was from a higher power. You would have to be blind not to see that. To read the King James Bible and not see the hand of God, you would have to be blind. They weren't paid for their work, by the way. So they weren't doing it for money. Only 12 received any money, and that was the 12 that oversaw the final revision. And they only received a weekly allowance for basic expenses because they had to live in London during those 9 months. They weren't paid for their work. What about King James then? What did he do? What did he have to do with the translation? Almost nothing. He didn't choose the translators. He didn't do any of the translation. The stingy guy didn't even fund the work. And apparently, he did not even initial an official authorization when it was completed. If he did, it doesn't exist. No one's been able to ever find it. What did he have to do with it? Almost nothing, but it bears his name. Let's consider the nature of this translation, the King James Bible. It is a masterpiece of Bible translation. A masterpiece of Bible translation, the King James Bible. It wonderfully conforms to the Hebrew and Greek. It has been called the miracle of English prose. The miracle of English prose. I have about 30 books in my library that exalt the King James Bible's language, just the language. When Harvard University Press published their literary guide to the Bible in 1987, what Bible did they choose to represent the literary qualities of the Bible, the King James Bible? And this is why they said they did that. They chose the King James Bible. Our reasons for doing so must be obvious. It is the version most English readers associate with the literary qualities of the Bible. It is still arguably the version that best preserves the literary effects of the original languages. 1987, NIV was there then. That's what Harvard University Press said then. Well, those these and thous, that old language there, what about all that? Shouldn't we take that out? No, we shouldn't take the these and thous out. Thee, thou, thy, and thine are in the King James Bible for a reason, for accuracy. To help us to understand where the Greek and Hebrew uses the plural in the second person pronoun. And the Hebrew and Greek make a distinction there, but English in modern days does not. You go over there and get me a Coke. Or you go over there and get me a Coke. Be a lot of Cokes. But that's the same thing in English. You, you. You singular, you plural. Modern English makes no distinction, but we'd have that in the King James Bible. One example, look at John 3. Or listen as I read this very, very famous passage. The ye must be born again passage. Thee and thou, thine and thy and thine, you and yours. In John 3:7, Jesus said, in John 3:7, marvel not that I said unto thee, ye must be born again. Well, there we have the Greek. See, if you don't know Greek, it's all right, because thee is singular and you. The T's are always singular. The Y's and that pronoun are always plural. The ye and your and yours, there's always plural. Thee, thy, thou, and thine are always singular. And there you have it. But why? Because of accuracy. Because that's the only way we English people have to know today in modern times that distinction between the singular and plural. And that's pretty important. Ye, thou. Marvel not and said unto thee, Nicodemus. You yourself, Nicodemus. Ye, all of you, must be born again. And Nicodemus understood that very well. Oh, he's talking to me. Oh, he's talking to all of us. But if you don't have a King James Bible and have the these and the thy and thou and thine, you don't know that. And so look for that as you read, because that's a matter of accuracy. The King James Bible quickly gained ascendancy over the Geneva Bible. Quickly. Now, some histories have misstated this. But between 1611 and 1614, at least 17 editions of the KJV were published, but only six of the Geneva, for that first 3 years after. And between 1611 and 1644, there were 182 editions of the KJV, but only 15 of the Geneva. And that Geneva quickly was replaced by the King James Bible. Why? The people loved it. That's the only reason. Nobody was advertising it. In any kind of modern sense, it simply, people liked it. And it replaced the King James Bible very quickly. In fact, by 1618, the Geneva was no longer printed in England. And by 1640, it was no longer imported even from Holland because nobody wanted to buy it. Now, the King James Bible underwent some minor revisions between 1629 and 1769. Some minor revisions. And those revisions were associated with those presses, Cambridge. And it is often said, of course, by those that want to degrade the King James Bible and want to give people the impression that their King James Bible is not the same as it used to be, that there are 40,000, 50,000 changes been made. Yeah, there have. But tell me this. What is the difference between S-I-N-N-E and S-I-N? Not anything. What's the difference between B-O-R-N-E and B-O-R-N? Nothing. What's the difference between B-L-I-N-D-E and B-L-I-N-D? Nothing. Blind, blind. Sin, sin. Born, born. That was the vast, overwhelming part of those changes were simply that kind of thing. Well, then, how different really is the KJV of today than 1611? Well, Dr. Donald Waite did an extensive research on that 1 year, set himself the task of taking the 1611 KJV and comparing it to a modern Oxford edition of the KJV, word by word. And he found that there were 136 changes. Only 136! Most of those very, very minor, out of 791,328 words. Well, it hasn't changed. Think about that. Four centuries. Four centuries. The King James Version is still revered by millions of English-speaking people today. In 1995, I wrote to Thomas Nelson Publishers, to find out what English version has the greatest sales. Now remember, 1995, 7 years ago. This is what they wrote to me. This is what Philip Stoner, Vice President, Biblical and Religious Reference Publishing, Thomas Nelson, wrote to me on April 4th, 1995. He said, all general distributors sell more KJV than NIV. Now, that was 7 years ago. That's from the horse's mouth. He said, unfortunately, there is no industry-wide report available. He explained to me why some have stated that the NIV outsells it back then. He said, that perspective is based on data reported by Spring Arbor distributors, which footnotes in their report that their figures are based only on their distribution. And so that was only 7 years ago that KJV was still outselling the NIV in America with no advertising. No advertising. Who is advertising the KJV? You go into the average bookstore, you have to dig around to find one. Still outselling. That's amazing. 400 years. In spite of the campaign that's been waged for 100 years to try to get people to read the modern versions. Well, let's think in conclusion about Tyndale's influence still today upon the KJV. Much of the powerful and direct and energetic language that we have in our old English Bible just comes to us directly from old Tyndale, who was running around hiding all the time, trying to get this work done, hiding from Rome. And so, even though it's been revised, most of it is still the Tyndale Bible. 9/10 of 1 John in our King James Bible is Tyndale. 5/6 of the book of Ephesians is directly out of Tyndale. And those proportions are maintained throughout those parts that Tyndale completed. The Tyndale Bible has affected the whole world. The Tyndale Bible reformed England and created out of it a great missionary sending nation. The light's gone out now. But the Tyndale Bible did that, and the Word of God went to the ends of the earth under that old British flag. In the 16th century, John Fox, who was observing and documenting the persecutions of that era, this is what he said was going on because of the Tyndale Bible. Everyone that could bought the book or busily read it or got others to read it to them if they could not themselves. And divers more elderly people learned to read on purpose. Old people, never been able to read. Why read? There's nothing to read worth reading. But now there's this Bible. I've got to learn how to read. An old person learning how to read. Why, they wanted to read that Bible. And even little boys flocked among the rest to hear portions of the Holy Scripture read. And it transformed that nation. And it created the United States of America, a nation that in former days was a spiritual light to the entire world. And what created this nation? This book. This book, period, made America great. And America was created as a bastion of religious liberty by those who believed this book and escaped persecution to establish a land of freedom where the Word of God could be preached. It motivated the founders to seek religious liberty. It inspired America's political documents. What did this book did? And our judges and our court systems originally. And it built the hundreds of thousands of churches that once upon a time made this a great land. What did this did? They were built upon nothing else. Well, look with me at Philippians 2. 5 through 13, as we close this morning. Philippians 2, 5 through 13. I'm going to read to you out of Tyndale. You look at the King James Bible. And you can see we still have a lot of Tyndale. Philippians 2, 5 through 13. I'm going to read out of the Tyndale Bible. You look in the King James. Philippians 2, 5 through 13. A beautiful passage about Christ. Let the same mind be in you, the which was in Christ Jesus, which being in the shape of God, and thought it not robbery to be equal with God, nevertheless he made himself of no reputation, and took on him the shape of a servant, and became like unto men, and was found in his apparel as a man. He humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God hath exalted him, and given him a name above all names, that at the name of Jesus every knee bow, both of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth. And that all tongues should confess that Jesus Christ is the Lord, unto the praise of God the Father. Wherefore, my dearly beloved, as ye have always obeyed, not when I was present only, but now much more in mine absence, even so perform your own health with fear and trembling. For it is God which worketh in you, both the will and also the deed, even of good will. Yeah, there's changes, but it's mostly old Tyndale. It's mostly old Tyndale. In fact, one of the miracles of history is that this esteemed committee of 47 to 50 great scholars didn't change very much. That is one of the miracles of history, if you know anything about scholars. Let's pray. Father, how we thank you for this book. And Lord, we pray that we, Lord, would take a stand for it today. And Lord, not be cowed by the attacks upon it. And Lord, not be ashamed of it. There's nothing like it. And we thank you that you've given it to us. In Jesus' name, amen.